really antsy on this topic, and I'm grateful now that I can finally dedicate some good time to it, okay? I'm going to be talking about the death of niche cable television. So I know this is Sleepless with Steve. I know I'm usually talking movies, but I'm going to be switching gears just a little bit right now to talk about niche cable television, particularly cable television is a broader thing. And then we're going to go into some specific examples of different channels that have not been doing so well in recent time. So as we all know, or many of us know at least, there's been a thing known as cord cutting or cord shaving recently. Basically, this process is people, mainly millennials, recognizing that their television habits do not warrant a full cable package subscription. Nonetheless, if they're going to go for Comcast or something, moreover, whether or not they'd go for something satellite like DirecTV, where you need a whole new satellite dish installed on the roof of your house. I've grown up my entire life with DirecTV. Okay, I like it a lot. I think it's a very nice network. The only problem is, of course, when it does rain or the satellite or when it gets excessively cloudy, the satellite dish does get blocked, so you do not get television. But I do like satellite dish overall. But here's the main meat of this. Okay, and I'm going off of a network or a television network, a channel that was discontinued earlier this year. The network was called Cloo, C-L-O-O. And it was basically a rerun network for shows like Law & Order, NYPD Blue, a lot of Magnum PIs, another one I believe that aired on the network. It was just kind of a grab bag of reruns. That's really all it was, okay? Now, one of the things that led to Clue's demise was that in 2013, it was booted from about 14 million Dish Network homes. Dish Network dropped the network entirely. So then what happened was by 2016, according to Nielsen, Clue averaged only about 51,000 primetime viewers a night. So that is about a 0.03 rating in the adults 18 to 49 demographic. That's miserable. By comparison, TV's most watched network, CBS, averages about 8.8 million primetime viewers. And Fox News, on the other hand, averages about 2.5 million. All of this information, I should have mentioned, much of this information is indeed coming from a variety of sources, one of which is Streaming Observer. It's been very instrumental with this, with my research to this as well. Another one is Advertising Age, which is really, really nice. You know what I mean? Really good website, too, that I've been getting a lot of information from. But it goes beyond that, okay? I don't want to make this a numbers game, but here we go. Another network, which I liked quite a bit when it first aired. I don't have much use for it now. It's premiered a year ago. It's MTV Classic. That was originally VH1 Classic. Then they rebranded it, rebooted it with MTV programming. Now it's just really just going to be a shell of what it even was a year ago this past August. It is TV's lowest rated nationally distributed English language network. It drew about 31,000 primetime viewers last year. Again, now another network from Viacom is known as Centric. That averages about 59,000 nightly viewers. Logo, the network averages about 73,000. And Chiller, the horror network, averages about 64,000. It's not doing much better than Clue did when Clue was axed this past February. So the point behind all this, okay? I'm willing to bet that if you still subscribe to cable, if you still have Comcast, Xfinity, DirecTV, Dish Network, I'm willing to bet if you have one of those, you probably have one of those networks I mentioned, whether it be MTV Classic, Fusion, Centric, Fuse, Chiller, one of these networks. These networks that I'm fairly certain, judging by these numbers, maybe you haven't watched them. Maybe you've never even heard of them. You're paying for them. And this is a big, big problem with these cable packages. Now these cable companies are so desperate to get your money that what they are doing is they are basically bending over backwards in order to release what's known as skinny bundles. Skinny bundles are like boiled down 20 networks for a cable subscription. The big CBS, NBC, ABC, locally Chicago WGN, a lot of these local or a lot of these, you know, bigger networks that gain, that hoard all these views. You're looking at these specialty networks, according to Streaming Observer, like Boomerang, MLB. MLB Network, MTV, Fox Business Channel. These are eking out just a couple, about 100,000, 200,000 views a night, when some of the biggest networks are getting more than 5 million viewers a night. Networks like ESPNU aren't even doing well. The Golf Channel, GAC, Country, and even IFC, the Independent Film Channel. These are networks that are struggling to gain and maintain any kind of traction, okay? Now, obviously, one of the big blames rests on the internet, of course. And I mean, you know, the internet has made things massively convenient. We want what we want when we... And that is what the internet has given us. It's given us something that's everything's on demand. And then we get streaming bundles where we can, or like Netflix or Amazon Amazon Streaming, okay? Hulu as well. There's a myriad of different streaming networks. These allow us, again, to watch what we want, when we want, what we want overall. That's the kicker with these streaming networks, is they give us that. Now, do they have commercials? Yeah, they have ads and stuff like that, but it's not like putting up with your average cable TV. You want a miserable time? Watch a movie on MTV. I just saw it a couple weeks ago when I was on vacation. Go watch a Superbad on MTV. Watch not only the edited cut, but try sitting through all these commercials with it. It's miserable. It's absolutely miserable. And going forward, niche cable television, in the form of even these bigger networks, BT, TV Land, ABC Family, the networks that specialize in syndicated programs and so on, they're going to have a hard time competing. Especially, like I said, a lot of these specialty channels like MTV Classic, they are not producing any programming. They are showcasing programming from yesteryear. And that is a difficult thing to market, especially when you have an era now where television is very popular. You got shows like The Walking Dead that are continuing to air, Better Call Saul, brand new original programming. People don't really want to watch reruns. And if people do, they'll catch reruns on bigger networks of shows that are either currently running or recently ended. That's why the Two and a Half Men reruns on CBS do so well in numbers. Okay, so that's another problem too, is you're getting people, if people want to watch reruns of programs, they go to their own networks, even like Nickelodeon or even ABC Family, which I know still produces a few TV shows. They go to those. They don't go to like Cloo or Chiller or MTV Classic or Boomerang. They don't really go to those. So when you're having channels, especially when we talk about inequality a lot, and obviously there's a lot of social inequality, but if you want to talk about equality in like television, CBS is averaging about 8 million viewers a night. Boomerang's averaging about 150,000. Those aren't promising numbers, and they're dangerous numbers going forward in terms of really trying to maintain these successful channels. And now when you have people, if they're going to even opt for cable, again, a lot of people are just, you know, cutting away, doing away with it altogether. They would rather buy a Roku box or something. They would rather get a subscription to Netflix because cable's just gotten too expensive. Even with skinny bundles too, it's become a bit of a pain to try to manage all that, you know? So I've been reading recently just about these niche cable networks and how they're kind of struggling to survive too. And I mean, a lot of these, again, like I've been saying, are specializing in reruns, specializing in syndicated programming too. And small networks can no longer survive on reruns when you have something like Netflix or on-demand options, when people don't have to wait. I mean, even DVRs too. DVRs were popular for a long time, and then DVRs wound up going the way of Netflix. Again, it was another thing where DVR is convenient. It's not as convenient as Netflix, not as convenient as having my own sort of watch list of binge watch at any given time and don't have to put up with commercials. So again, this is not my forte. I'm not an expert with TV and stuff like that. I don't watch a lot of TV personally. Again, if I watch TV, I watch a lot of reruns in my life. I watch a lot of kids shows too that I grew up watching. I know I'm very strange, but at the end of the day, it's coming back to the idea too that these networks just cannot survive on these such low viewership. And the forecast isn't promising. It's very similar to movies too, with the fact that a lot of movies are underperforming at the box office, and theaters are either trying to come up with new gimmicks to get butts in seats, or they are really trying to, you know, get people to come out and like get, you know, offer things that you can only get in the theater. So it's stuff like that. So I see television and movies as very synonymous in a lot of ways, in terms of looking at them as industries, in terms of looking at them and how they have to compete with the internet, which is still, again, very new and very different to manage, and a lot of people aren't used to managing content the way they were.